He was attractive, he was very charismatic, he had a lot of friends, and it was sort of like a dream come true. It was like, oh wow, this guy is actually interested in me.
Georgia was just 18 when she was swept off her feet by a handsome 20-year-old Navy recruit.
I remember after only 3 weeks, he told me that he loved me.
They met in Melbourne, but he was posted to Sydney. 2 years later, when she finished uni, Georgia agreed to join him. She says the relationship quickly turned violent.
So it was quite frightening and confronting for me, having made such an enormous leap.
Over the years, Georgia claims there were many other violent episodes. She says he would gaslight her into believing it was her fault.
Did you think about leaving?
I genuinely believed what he was telling me, that no one else would ever love me. And I think once you're told for so long that it is, you know, solely your fault, you convince yourself that you're the one that needs to change to fix this situation, and that if you could just change, then he'll stop. There were good times as well. So there were happy times when, you know, our wedding, everyone that came to our wedding was, you know, this is the best wedding we've ever been to. You two are such a beautiful couple. And we bought our first home together and it was really exciting.
A year after they were married, Georgia fell pregnant and claims her husband made a shocking demand.
He didn't want a girl, and he used to tell me, you know, it's a boy or an abortion. He was so adamant about the fact that he only wanted a boy.
Why a boy? Why did he want a boy?
He always said to me that he wanted to make sure he had the first boy in the family.
What? Really?
Yes, he used to say that to me. So I remember we found out at 10 weeks that it was a boy, and that was a huge relief for me, obviously, giving him what he wanted.
But she says the abuse continued throughout her pregnancy.
So he was hurting you while you were pregnant?
Yeah, he was, yeah.
There's nothing you did.
No, and it wasn't my fault in terms of the violence was not my fault. But as a mum, you know, you have an obligation to protect your baby. So, yeah, it's a lot.
On the day of her 20-week scan, Georgia didn't hear from her husband all day. Her calls to him went unanswered, and by 9 p.m, she began to panic. She was about to call the police when he finally arrived home, telling her he'd broken his phone and was trying to get it fixed.
And I just remember, I just was like, there's just, something's not right here. So I kept pressing him. And that's when he told me that day he'd been arrested and that he was facing charges of child sexual abuse.
He was charged with using a carriage service to groom a person under 16 years.
What did you do?
I took my wedding ring off. I left it on the bathroom bench and I packed a bag and I left. Yeah, I walked out and I went to my parents' place.
Georgia would never return to her husband after that, but facing the prospect of having a baby with a child sex offender, she needed to find out all she could.
The only contact I received from the police was the next day in court. I had the arresting officer walk up to me and he said, "You're the wife, aren't you?" And I said, "Yes." And he said, "How many weeks pregnant are you?" And then he handed me a brochure for partner speak, and that was the only communication I received from the police. As hard as I tried, I was always told, "No, you have no right to know. You have no right to know what's going on. We can't give you any information."
George's experience is now part of a training program for police investigators working to improve their relationships with families.
When we walk away, we know that we've turned a family's life upside down. We know by knocking on that door and handing over that search warrant that their life will never be the same.
Last year, 226 people were charged with child sex offences, which means there are a lot of families needing help from groups like Partner Speak.
Partner Speak's goal is that within 24 hours of discovering that crime, every non-offending partner and affected family member will know about Partner Speak, and the same way we know when to tell our friends to call Lifeline.
4 months after he was charged, George's son was born.
My son deserved to have a father that was, you know, present at the birth. My son deserved to have a mother that was happy and safe and calm, not stressed out. And my son deserved the best. And I was so shattered that I couldn't give that to him.
He pleaded guilty to using a carriage service to groom a person under 16 years. He believed he was talking to two schoolgirls aged 14 and 15 on social media, but they turned out to be police operatives. His messages proved he knew both girls were underage when he requested nude photos and asked them to meet with him.
It's horrifying and disgusting, yeah.
Did you have a physical reaction to it? It's something that if I... Yeah.
Even thinking about it now, it makes me feel sick. The public reaction is that he is a monster, and that gives me a sense of justice.
But public opinion makes little difference at the time of sentencing.
So he was convicted on two charges, and one sentence was a 2.5-year suspended sentence. The other was 150 hours of community service and listed on the sex offenders register for 15 years, but he didn't serve a day in prison. The judge in his sentencing actually said that the end of your marriage and the resulting impact that that's had on your relationship with your newborn child is essentially sufficient punishment to deter you from ever conducting these acts again. And to me, that is just horrifying.
Georgia feels let down by the law generally.
They told me that I was in no immediate danger and that I needed to go to the courts.
When she got there, she says she was accused of taking too long to make a complaint.
Did that feel like you'd been gaslit and abused all over again?
Yeah, they were treating me like I was a vindictive ex-wife, basically, yeah.
Luckily, justice prevailed in the one area of George's life that matters most.
I ended up getting sole custody, so I moved away. He doesn't know where I live, and he has no contact with my son.
Nevertheless, there are occasions where she's not allowed to forget her ex-husband.
The only time it really bothers me is when someone who knows my ex-husband says to me, oh my gosh, he looks so much like him, because he really does. And that, to me, I just say, we don't talk about that. But yeah, it is difficult.
It will get to a point when your little boy is maybe a teenager, he might start asking questions about his dad. What will you tell him? Have you thought about that yet?
Yes, I think about that a lot and it scares me. What do you tell someone so small and, you know, what's age appropriate when he starts asking? How do you tell someone all of that? What happens if he does eventually want to meet him and how will I navigate that? And these are all probably going to be hurdles that we have to overcome as a family. I try not to be too critical about my ex-husband in the sense that I try not to sway my son's future opinion of him, if that makes sense. I want my son to deal with facts, to understand the facts, and then to be able to make the decision himself.
Tell me about your son, your beautiful son.
Yeah, he's incredible. He's 3 now. He turned 3 a couple of weeks ago. My son is my saviour, I think. He's the reason why I survived all of this, and he's the reason, you know, from the day he was born, I had a reason to get out of bed every day and a reason to keep fighting. And I hope that by doing things like this and speaking out and sharing our story, that one day he's going to grow up and be, you know, that's my mum, and I'm so proud of her. And to look at his mum and say, you know, she's a fighter.
Wow.
Georgia is the most extraordinary young woman, and I just have to commend her on her bravery and courage to tell her story. She doesn't see herself as a victim, but when these heinous crimes are committed, particularly involving children and online sex abuse, there are these secondary victims. So the partners, the wives, the children, the families of these people who've committed crime, and they need support as well. Thank God for charities like PartnerSpeak, but from the end of April, PartnerSpeak will only be available in Victoria. In order to keep these critical services national, they need your support. If you'd like to help, you can visit our website for all the details.
Also, for national 24-hour counselling helpline and support, you can call 1-800-RESPECT, so that number 1-800-737-732.